Welcome back to our series on the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus' great teaching at the start of Matthew's Gospel. I hope you did have a chance to look at Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 to 16. And if you did, and if you remember from our first session, you'll realise that Jesus is laying out the terms of a deal between God and us. It's an offer that God is making to become part of his kingdom. Now, I've called this offer a deal. That's not quite the language the Bible uses. Sometimes it calls it a covenant, sometimes it calls it a promise, sometimes it calls it a testament. So this offer that we've been given to become part of God's great kingdom now, that is the New Testament. And it's an offer that God made again and again throughout history, but this is the final offer. This is the offer made by Jesus, God's own Son, here on earth. And it's made possible by his death on the cross and his resurrection. And the terms of the deal is that if we repent and put our faith in Jesus, then our sins can be forgiven. And because he lived a perfect life and because he rose again from the dead, it means that we can be put right with God. It means that we are no longer constrained by the sin and the guilt of having to live in line with all the rules and regulations of the law that God set out. That was the basis of the former deal, the former covenant. And Jesus makes it clear in his teaching that there is absolutely nothing that we can do to earn the right to take this offer up. God has given us a chance to be part of this kingdom, but it is his free gift for us. So that's the basis of the Sermon on the Mount. But if you enter into a deal, if you take up an offer, what do you need? You need a contract. And if you read a contract, or and this is my house insurance policy, then often at the beginning of things like this, there will be an opportunity to lay out exactly who the parties to this deal are. So here you go. This is the Vincent house insurance policy. And it says this: we, the insurers, specified in this document, this is Lloyds Bank General Insurance Limited. And then a bit further on, you, the person named in this policy schedule as the policyholder. Riveting stuff. But the deal laid out in the Sermon on the Mount starts with the same sort of thing. God, the eye of the deal. Well, that's clear from history, it's clear from creation, and it's made clearer by Jesus himself, particularly in John's Gospel with all of those great I am passages. But what about the you in this contract, in this offer? Who is this offer being made to? Who is being welcomed in to God's new kingdom? Well, let's have a look at the first few verses of the sermon and we'll find out. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So, that's the you of the deal. Now, in the previous offers, the you was defined by nationality or ancestry. It was the Israelites. It was the descendants of Abraham. It was the nation of Israel. But now you is, well, it's not who you might think. It's not the learned. It's not the religious leaders. It's not those who are successful in the eyes of those around them. It's not those who look strong who get to be part of God's kingdom. No, the you of the contract, well, it's us, it's any of us, but we are the outsiders here. Now, in one sense, we are outsiders because we are outcasts from God's great plan. In Paul's letter to the Colossians, he says that we were once alienated from God because of our evil behaviour. As I said, we might want to be part of this deal, but God owes us nothing. There is nothing we can do to earn entry into God's kingdom. And this is where the insurance policy analogy breaks down a little bit, because we are not equal partners in this deal. But we're also outsiders because we are called to be different from the rest of the world around us. The people in the kingdom are the meek. They are those who are persecuted, and they are people who offer mercy to others because they know that God has offered mercy to them when they deserved nothing. And so these are the people that are blessed. And blessed just means made happy by God. These are the people that are renewed by the Holy Spirit working in us. And Jesus goes on to say a little bit later on in that passage that the people who are made happy will in turn be salt and light for those around us. So we've defined the parties to the deal. But this deal, this contract, it comes with conditions. My insurance policy comes with the conditions too. It covers the theft of my bike, but not if the bike is left in a shed and the shed is unlocked, and not if I forget to chain the bike to a secure object. I've got to fulfill certain conditions if I'm going to carry on receiving the benefits of the insurance policy. And there are conditions on being part of God's kingdom too. And these first few verses of the Sermon on the Mount, they're a call from Jesus to live the way that the king wants us to live in this kingdom. And throughout the Bible, every time God makes this offer to his people, the call is the same. The call is, be holy because I am holy. It's the same here. Be like this. Be meek. Be merciful. Thirst for righteousness because this is what I, your father, the king, am like. And Jesus shows us 8 aspects of the character and the conduct that he expects of the citizens of the kingdom. And I think you should go away and have a look at all 8 and think about what those mean for you. But let's just pick out a few now. Verse 4, for instance, those who mourn are made happy by God. Seriously? Even now? Even with all this going on? Yes. Because those who mourn have seen the depths of the world's suffering. These are people who know just how much the world and all the people in it needs God. And so they are ready to receive the deep comfort that only God can bring. Verse 7, those who are merciful are made happy by God. They know how blessed they are to be part of this kingdom. They understand what it means to be given something that they don't deserve. And out of that gratitude, they then show mercy to the people around them. But if you jump forward to verse 11, you can see what is coming our way if we become part of that kingdom. People will call us names. People will slander us. People will persecute us, all because we follow Jesus. And what are we called to do? Not hide away, not keep it quiet, but to live it out, to be salt and light. Kingdom citizens have to get involved. We have to show the rest of the world what God is like. We need to get stuck in. We need to be shining God's light into dark places. We need to bring hope and joy to those around us in what we do and what we say. The only infection that we want to see here is the infection of our goodness spreading out, our goodness given to us by God, growing in us through the power of the Holy Spirit and then spreading out to those around us so that we can make a difference. For next week, we're going to be looking at quite a long chunk, chapter 5, verses 17 to 37. So please do have a look at that passage before we get to the next video. But as well as doing that, why don't you think about these few things based on what we've looked at today. So first of all of those markers of living in the kingdom that Jesus mentions in this passage, which of them do you struggle with most? Which of them do you see least of in your life as you strive to live out being a citizen of God's kingdom? But then think as well, you've got the power of the Holy Spirit that you can invite in, and he can transform you and renew you so that you can live a life of the citizen of God. So how are you going to do that this week?